New Emission Process. Bram Stralung. It is a German term. Many of you are German, so you exactly know what it means. For the non German speakers, it means a kind of slowing down radiation. Okay? Breakdown radiation. Because what's going to be interesting in this process, and what is going to be involved in this process, is going to be a free electron, and we are going to get an ion with a charge ZE. Okay? What's happening? That if we are dealing with this sort of situation, the electron is going to perceive the Coulomb force exerted by our ion. Since the ion is going to be all the time way more smaller than our electrons, even if we're talking about hydrogen, fully ionized hydrogen, because the mass of the ion is going to be, the proton is going to be, in this case the proton is going to be 2000 times larger than the one of the electron. Therefore we can assume our ion not to move, not to feel the acceleration given by the incoming electron. We just neglect it. So, if without the ion we would have no Coulomb force, no force exerted in the electron, it would move along a straight line. Since there is the Coulomb force acting on, on the electron, we are going to have an acceleration pointing toward the pointing toward the ion, and the trajectory is going to be deflected. Okay? Which sort of deflection we are going to have? Well, the potential of the Coulomb force is a radius to the minus one. Like gravity, like the gravitational force. So which one kind of trajectory do we expect? A capillary motion. Where you can have closed orbit, where you could have closed elliptical orbits, very rare, because you need the right amount of energies involved, or hyperbolic trajectories, very much more likely in the situation that we are considering. Okay? So we know already what is the equation of motion of our electron, which is given by a Keplerian motion. Now, if the motion is going to be of this sort, we have an acceleration which is pointing in the direction of the ion, and therefore we are going to have an emission from this accelerated electron. This is Bram-Stralung radiation. Okay? Now, let's define a few angles. So we have our free electron. Let's define the x-axis, let's define the vector pointing, connecting the electron and the ion, which are separated by a separation r. We define this angle phi, and that's it. Okay, and then, yeah, that's it. Good. Since we are dealing with the Keplerian orbit, I'm not going to do the full derivation of Keplerian orbit because it's extremely boring, it's completely irrelevant, and I think that you already met it in other lectures. They are kind of typical examples also in Physics 1 when you're looking for forces, so I'm not going through that again. So, I just specify what this orbit is going to be. And everything is spinning around the energy of our electron, which is going to be equal to 1 half m r dot square plus e square over 2 m r square. So that's the kinetic term that is split in terms of a radial component and the one associated to the angular momentum of the electron. And then we have the potential, which is ze times e, because we have the two charges involved, over R. That's our kinetic in Angular terms. And given this system, our radius with respect to the angle phi is going to be equal to p 1 plus epsilon cosinus of phi to the minus 1, where p is equal to L squared, that's the angular momentum of the electron, ze squared m, that's the orbital parameter, we have epsilon, which is the eccentricity, centricity, and then we are going to have P, which is equal to A, that's the same major axis of the orbit, again this is a parameter of our orbit, that is related to the orbital parameter. Now, if we are using this expression for this, the definition of these parameters in this our orbit, and we compute a time derivative of this guy, we can get our R dot. E of the electron to the power of 2 and R squared over 2A plus R minus A epsilon squared minus 1 over 2. Okay, let's call it equation 1 and equation 1 and equation 2. Okay, then to simplify our life, it's convenient to rephrase all of this expression in terms of what is called eccentric anomaly. Eccentric anomaly in which the radius is now not a parameter of the angle phi, but of this new parameter. Again, this is one of the other ways to express the Keplerian motion. And as you see, now we are not going to have cosinuses of an angle, as we have here, but we are going to have an hyperbolic cosinus of this function. So if you wish, is an angle with respect to hyperbolic trigonometry. Again, we do the same trick. We can have R dot of psi equal to A epsilon sinus hyperbolicus of psi dot. That's our equation of 3. Now we have two expressions, R dot and R dot, that are connected, and I can plug equation 2 into here. So if we combine equation 2 and 3, what we can do is to identify the time variation of the anomaly. Psi dot square is equal to E square, identify the square because this is relevant later, epsilon sinus hyperbolicus of psi minus 1. Okay? And this allows us to connect the time variation of the eccentric anomaly with respect to time, because psi dot, as you know, is the psi over the t. And therefore, you can get our dt out of it. Dt is going to be d phi over phi dot. We have the connection between time and the anomaly, which allow us to find out a new time, if you wish. we had a time, which is a time interval, that is in between a time zero and a certain amount of time t, which is just an integral of the t prime function that is now going to be expressed in terms of the eccentric anomaly, as I said. So it is going to be the integral between zero and psi of the psi prime over the over psi dot, just by using this trick. Okay, that's what we did. So we have now an expression of time with respect to the eccentric anomaly. So the idea here is to work with this sort of expressions because it's easier to manage them. Okay? And since it's expressed in terms of this extrinsic of this anomaly, which is kind of, you know, it's not very intuitive how it's running something as a function of this anomaly, we translate it in terms of a time. So we have a link between time and the anomaly. Intrinsic anomaly. And if we do now the integral, we have this dot, we just plug it in, we solve our integral, and we get epsilon minus sinus hyperbolicus minus psi. Well, we can define a new time tau as the integral of ma squared over ze squared. Here we have expressed everything in a more convenient way, and what we just need to do is to set up the initial condition for our system, right? For our electron. And the most convenient way to do that, init condition, is to look at the energy at the infinite, right? Where R is equal to infinite. And when R is going to be equal to infinite, the influence, the impact of this ion on our electron is going to be zero. So what we are going to be left with is only the potential energy given by the Coulomb force. So we are going to have the kinetic energy, which is respect to the velocity of the particle. Let me rephrase it. So at infinite, what is going to be relevant is the kinetic term, which is given by the velocity of our electron at infinite, right? If you want this electron to reach the ion, it's moving. Therefore, it possesses some kinetic energy. And now I express it in this way because we don't care anymore about a radial direction and an angular momentum with respect to the ion, who is very, very far away and we don't care about. Okay? But what is relevant is the intrinsic velocity of the particle far away from the electron, which must be equal to the potential energy at the minimum distance with respect to the orbit where the other kinetic terms are going to be equal to zero. And then we have ZA, given the expressions that we have. Okay? Sorry, 2A. Where A is equal to ZE squared over MV squared. Okay? So we can measure this A by setting the initial conditions. Okay? And with that, we have everything. So we have the connection of the time with this tau that we define up there. So, I mean, we have basically the connection between time and the intrinsic anomaly, sinus hyperbolic of psi minus psi. Then we have the expression of the radius as a function of the anomaly, epsilon cosinus hyperbolic of psi minus 1. And we have the angle, alpha, cosinus of phi, with respect, again, to the anomaly, cosinus hyperbolicus of psi, and epsilon, cosinus of hyperbolicus of psi minus 1. Okay? Now, when we are going to compute the power, the spectrum of the radiation, what do we need? Fourier transforms, right? Therefore, if we want to compute the Fourier transform of a function, we are actually computing an integral with the exponential times the function over time. Therefore, we need dt. Dt that we get out of this expression. So we have dt equal to tau, just the derivative, epsilon sine of hyperbolicus of psi minus 1 in the psi. Okay, so we are rephrasing the Fourier transform, we are going to rephrase the Fourier transforms, not in times, in terms of time derivatives, but in respect of derivatives with respect to psi. And then we need the acceleration, right? On the x and y component, for instance. And therefore, we can use this two expressions. You see, we have the angle alpha that allow us to find out what is the position of our particle with respect to our the position of our particle with respect to the angle. Okay? And we just use, that's correct. And this is going to be equal to A epsilon minus cosinus hyperbolicus of psi. And Y can be easily derived by, so that's what I did, I just plug it into here. So what then we can do is to then compute, since we know what is the radius, what is the component y, which is nothing but r squared minus x squared, Pythagoras theorem. Which again is going to be equal to a square root of epsilon squared minus 1 sinus hyperbolicus of psi. So now we know what is the r vector with respect to x and y, given the intrinsic anomaly. And here we start with the real business. 3. We compute the Fourier transform of our acceleration to find out what is the spectrum of the emitted radiation. Okay, so what we want to compute in the end is our vector Fourier transformed. Because this is the vector that is going to express fully the energy emission as a function of frequency of our accelerated electron. And I forgot to tell you that in this case we are not dealing with accelerated particles. Sorry, we are dealing with accelerated particles. We are now dealing with relativistic particles, okay? Beta is going to be way smaller than 1. Therefore, what we are going to do is not to use, going to use the full expression, generic expression that we use for synchrotron radiation, that required that, because we were dealing with relativistic particles, but we are just going to use the non-relativistic equation that just asks us to evaluate this quantity. Okay, we don't need to do vectors and stuff and all the mess we had before. Okay? Good. So let's do that. If we are looking for the Fourier transform, we have that x dot is going to be equal. So let's do it a bit more. A trick to look what is the Fourier transform is to look at what is the velocity of a particle, sorry, a velocity in general, Fourier transformed, okay? Whenever you have a Fourier transform and we are applying a derivative, you know that in the Fourier space, derivatives are basically given by products of your function with respect to omega. And this is happening because if you remember the expression for the Fourier transforms, we have the integral with respect to time of the function times an exponential where there is a minus I omega. Right? An exponential of minus I omega into the time component. If we apply the time derivative, sorry, of this quantity, minus I omega is a constant with respect to the minus t that is in exponential, it comes down. So we have a minus omega in front of the integral. Then we have the exponential, which remains an exponential, and we have the Fourier transform of the original function. Therefore, you get that the time derivative of a function in the Fourier space is nothing but minus I omega, the original function in the Fourier space. Okay, so derivatives, bottom line, derivatives in the Fourier space are minus omega multiplied the Fourier space function for which you want a derivative. Okay? Just play yourself with that if you're not confident with this. So, V, the Fourier transform of the velocity, we know that the velocity is the time derivative of the position, therefore we are going to have a minus I omega, which is the factor coming down from the exponential, times the velocity. So, you see, function minus I omega, this is the time derivative of x vector, which is our velocity, and all of it is in the Fourier space. Okay? Try to do it. Get the definition of the Fourier transform and make a time derivative of it. You will see that you will find the same integral, but with a minus omega in front. That's it. That's why it's convenient to work in the Fourier space in first place for many applications. Good. If we have that, then we have this expression in which we can now have our Fourier transform of the x component. You see, here is a vector of x, well, let me call it R then, as I did before. Then I get only the x component, which is going to be equal to I 1 over I omega, v velocity x, which is nothing but e over omega, and then we have the minus, and then we have the that's x dot Fourier transformed. Okay? Which is equal to minus I omega, integral from minus infinite and infinite, of dt x dot, that's the function we are computing the Fourier transform, and then we have the exponential omega t. Okay? Good. Then, here you understand why we had this link, why I made the derivative here of the time, because we need it, as I mentioned already before, for the Fourier transforms. And if we plug our expression into here, what we get now is a Fourier transform of our position, but now expressed in terms of the anomaly. So we are making the integral with respect to the anomaly. The x over the c, you see, this is just the t, e alla e omega t, and then we have the intrinsic anomaly. Now, what we have here, again, is some special function. So we see we have, again, an integral of something which is completely generic, and the AE omega t, where all the physical properties are captured by our anomaly, but in a mathematical sense, this is just an integral of an exponential. There's nothing more than that. Which is actually a Hankel function of type E mu. That's a function type of type 1, and actually this is the derivative with of I nu, of nu omega. Yes. Hankel function of order nu. Okay, again, one of the special functions, like the cosine, like could be the cosinus, you know how it looks like, you know what a Gaussian looks like. This is a bit more complex, it involves an integral, but it's just a known function. And the same goes for the Fourier transform in of the y component. I just give you the final result, minus a over omega epsilon, square root of epsilon squared minus 1 h e nu 1 of e nu epsilon. Okay? And now look at the difference. This is the derivative with respect to the variable of our anchor function, and this is just the anchor function, not the derivative. Good. We have everything now. We have everything now. What we have to do is just to plug in. What was there? 3, so that's 4. Plug in the equation of the spectrum non relativistic, which we derived, and we have that the energy with respect to the frequency, so I'm already integrated over all angles, is equal to 2e squared omega to the power of 4 over 3c to the power of 3, and then we have the modulus square of the Fourier transform of the position. Okay? Here you don't see an acceleration. You can ask, was the square root of the acceleration? Yes, but remember that the acceleration is the derivative of the position that give us some omega factor, some e omega factor. But this is the square modulus, the e disappears, because it's a e times e, and we just get the imprint of a frequency that is to the power of 4 now up here. Okay? But this is again, just to stress it, a more relativistic electron. And by plugging in our expression here, we have our final result, which is minus 2e pi squared over 3 tau epsilon c to the power of 3, d over the epsilon, epsilon h e nu of 1, e nu epsilon, plus times h I nu 1, the derivative of the anchor function of I nu epsilon, and that's it. And now you can say, what? This guy is an imaginary number? Negative? An emitted energy? Negative? Why? Well, these guys are complex. One of those is complex. There is a minus e in front, which gives you a plus 1 here. And yeah, good. We have an energy which is positive, and it's a real number. It's not a complex number. It's not an imaginary number. So, to arrive at these results, there are a lot of tedious and boring steps, most of which are completely non-funny and, if you wish, even interesting, because they are all dealing with the Keplerian motion. It's just a way of reshuffling the properties with respect to time, radius, and angle of the trajectory of an electron in a Keplerian orbit. The only physical concept that is in all of these boards up to that point is that we have a potential that scales with r to the minus 1. That's the physics that we are talking about. A potential with r to the minus 1 gives you a Keplerian orbit. That's the only stuff about physics that happened between here and here. And if you wish, another thing that that is relevant is the fact that all what we are deriving is expressed contains the initial condition for our electrons that are given by its velocity far away from the ion. These are the two physical concepts that you need to remember. Okay? Then, once we have our Keplerian orbit, given the initial condition, we can just compute the expression for the power spectrum, where again, in the previous lectures, that I express in terms of an acceleration to the power of 2. Now, everything is done in the Fourier space, therefore the derivative of the position is just an I omega in front of the position, that gives you a factor of omega to the power of 4 here. Okay, so you have a direct expression. Here you basically have contain your acceleration. Okay, from here to here you have your acceleration. Good. And then you just plug in your position, your Fourier transform of your vector, for which you compute the modulo square, and that's your power spectrum, which is as ugly as it gets. Okay? And it's expressed in terms of the Hankel functions. Good. But this is what? That's the story of one electron. Is that what you observe? No, because if we are dealing with something that is very far away, we need a lot of emission, such that it is perceived, and we need a lot of electrons that are going to emit with this process, such that we have a sufficient flux that allow us to observe it. Okay? Therefore, what we need are a lot of electrons. And where do you find free electrons? In ionized gases. Gas, ionized, a plasma. Okay? In this case, you have an extremely large number of electrons. You have an ionized medium, therefore you expect very high temperatures. It's a hot environment where you can have this ionization taking place. And you can make your observations. An example are galaxy clusters. Galaxy clusters, I'm going to show you a few pictures, and I'm going to show you a few of the examples to which you can apply all of that, are extremely large objects that contains many galaxies, that contains a lot of dark matter, I will speak also about that, which has a very strong gravitational potential and are formed through a collapse. Right? There are baryons, gas, you have your galaxies, dark matter and whatever, you have gravity which is making all these structures call one each other, you have the collapse. What's happening to a gas when you compress it? The temperature goes high. And since the compression is high, the temperature is so large that you get a fully ionized gas embedded into galaxy clusters, and they emit through Bremsstrahlung. And you observe them in the X-rays. So an extremely energetic radiation. And the energy is coming from the temperature, and temperature means high velocities for the electrons. Okay? But again, this is the energy output that you get for one electron, which has a very specific velocity at infinite. So that's among the two pieces of physics which is all of this board, this is the relevant one. So now what we need to do is to evaluate the overall emission given by all these free electrons in a plasma. Let me cancel this and let's keep the picture up there, which is useful. Okay, good. equals 4, so this must be 5. And what we need to do now is to integrate over the contributions of all E- in your plasma. Now we are considering gas, fully ionized, not individual particles. And what do we have there? We have that given one ion, ZE, positive charge, we have an electron which is coming with a certain impact parameter that we define as B. Right? At infinite, this will be the trajectory, and you have one electron that is coming with this beta, another electron with this beta, another electron with another beta, and so on and so forth. Of course, from all directions. But since we don't care for what is the inclination of the directions, because we can always change our frame, a particle which is coming from this direction have just another beta. So you understand that the only variable that is relevant is beta, the impact parameter. And again, it's going to be extremely boring steps of mathematics involving the orbits, and I just tell you that you can relate this is done in the script, so you can see the details if you are interested. You can relate the epsilon to the impact parameter, okay? Given a certain angular momentum for your particle. And it's clear that the B must depend on the angular momentum. Because if you have an impact straight away, the acceleration is going to be along the direction of motion of the electron. You're not going to have change in two angles, right? Therefore, you expect it B equal to zero. B equal to zero, no change in the direction, therefore no angular momentum component. L equal to zero, for instance. If it's further away, you're going to have a different kind of trajectories, therefore different contribution to the angular momentum. So that's the physical reasons why you have a connection between B and L. And then mathematically, you can just see how it comes about, and you find it in the notes. And then I remind you, so it's some board, I think I cancel it. So we have P that I was given by some expression. We have some infinite for which we know the expression, again related to the initial condition phi infinite. And then we have epsilon, which is given by the expression that was on that board, and L equal to B M V infinite. Okay? We can combine these four expressions that we derived before, and we get the connection between epsilon and the impact parameter B A squared. Okay, so you see, now we have a geometrical term, just how the electron is far away from the ion with respect to the x-axis, now, if we draw the x-axis in this direction, with respect to a parameter that characterizes the orbit. That's the trick. Okay? So we have a connection from orbit, the properties of the orbit, to geometry. B. That's the trick here. Why? Because if this is, we are going to have various electrons impacting with certain beta parameter, impact parameter on our ion, we need to integrate over the number of electrons that are coming the direction of our parameter as a function of B. And this involves a geometrical cross-section, because now we are really speaking about targets. Okay? It's just a geometrical cross-section, where we can set our ion here in the middle, and then we can define for a certain B a nanorus. Oh, that's horrible. Okay? Just a nanorus. No, this is in your direction, this is, wants to be inclined. Okay? And so an annulus which goes from B to B plus a certain dB. And the electrons are coming in this direction and given a certain density, number density of electrons, we are going to have a certain number of electrons on the surface dA. So we are counting, we want to know how many electrons, given a certain number density that characterizes the density of our medium, of our gas, of our ionized gas, we want to know how many we have within an annulus at a distance beta. Okay? And the number of electrons, so this is a big N, so this is an actual number of electrons within this delta area, the area, is equal to the number of electrons that we have. Twice the number of electrons, twice the number density, twice is going to be the number of electrons crossing that surface. That's obvious. Then what we have? We have the area, 2 pi b dB. This is just the area that we have here. And you see that it scales with B, and it makes sense, because if I take a way larger annulus, the area is going to be larger. And we have a proportionality factor between the area and the number density. But it is something instantaneous. We need to do it for a certain amount of time. And the amount of electrons that are going to cross at dt time that surface is going to be given by the velocity at infinite, because we assume that the change of the velocity is small with respect to the acceleration given by the Coulomb force with respect to dt. And this gives us the x. Okay? So we are counting how many electrons, so this is the number of electrons that are crossing our surface in an amount dt. This is, and you see that we have an area times dx, velocity times time, is actually a volume. Volume times a density, number density, gives you an actual number of electrons. Okay? So all the transformation from epsilon to B was, I mean, to connect B and epsilon was to deal with a geometrical cross-section. Okay? And if we now express this quantity with respect to the orbital parameters, we get ME, V infinite, A squared, epsilon, the epsilon, dt. Now that we know how many electrons we have, we have just to multiply this factor for the spectrum that we have for each individual one. Emission of an individual electrons, we know how many we have with a certain initial condition, the one that we use there, we know what is the global emission of those electrons. And the spectrum is going to be d to the power of e cube, the omega dt, dv, the integral between 0 and 1, of dE, the epsilon, that one, times the number of electrons that we have, the infinite, A square, epsilon, the epsilon. And look, there is the omega popping up here. Why? Because here, I'm dealing with a number density, which is a number per unit of volume. So if I would multiply, make the integral over the volume of the number density, I would have the total emission. Here is per unit of volume. A little chunk of material. Tututuk is emitting. Okay, let's see of the V. And This thing here has a name and it's called emissivity. Because it quantifies the amount of energy per unit of time, per unit of frequency of a chunk of your material. Emissivity is a property of your material. Okay? And I just give you the final expression. 6 pi z square e to the power of 6 and e and the electron over 3m square over c to the power of 3 v infinite square root of 3 and then we have the Gaunt factor which is a roughly constant given an initial condition v, a function of omega. This is a roughly constant, okay? It's just a function completely irrelevant that is roughly constant. Okay, let's call Gaunt factor. So G, what do they call it? F Gaunt factor. Is it the end of the story? No, it's not the end of the story. Because here we have all the population of electrons that are passing by our ion, but which have a specific velocity. So what do we need to do then? We need to integrate over the entire velocities such that we can sum up the contribution of the population of all electrons that can possess different velocities. And now you see that at this point, since we are dealing with the velocities of our electrons, we need to define the specific gas we deal with. Okay, is it thermal? Then we need to integrate over the Boltzmann distribution, such that the Boltzmann distribution tells us what is the number of electrons that we have with a certain velocity. Okay? Therefore, next time we will make a further step. So we integrated, we derive first the emission of one single encounter between an electron and an ion. We integrated over the population of electrons that have this very specific velocity at infinite over all possible impact parameter, we got this expression. One thing that I want you to notice is that here we are making distinction between the number of electrons and the number of ions. You say, if it's hydrogen, this is the same, right? Because you have one proton, one electron. If you have an ionized medium, the two numbers are the same. Yes, but if you have an element which is more, which is rich in chemistry, if there is iron, if there is helium or whatever, and this is ionized, you can have more electrons with respect to the ions that you have, because they possess more electrons that can become free. Okay, so I'm stressing these two components as well. Then we will continue and find out what is the total emission process given a plasma in a thermal, in thermal equilibrium. We are going to consider that case. Good, thank you very much.